Firing shells over long distances with the help of an artillery piece can devastate the enemy, especially when those shells end up dead center on the target's forehead. But a howitzer pointed straight ahead is a sign of trouble. It means that the enemy forces are within visual range, so both sides can see each other, which means they can shoot at each other. This is called direct fire, when the barrel of the howitzer is pointed almost parallel to the ground, as if it was a shotgun. Direct fire is usually a last resort and is done in self-defense. But under normal circumstances, artillery is designed for indirect fire, meaning that the crew cannot see the target. In this case, the weapon system is aimed upward to fire in an arc, usually over friendly forces and then impacting a faraway target. But why the soldier is looking through the gun sight even though he cannot possibly see the target? Why the metal rod that's used to push the round into the barrel is curved and not straight? And why the US Army would fire howitzer rounds that never impact the ground? It's not what you think. This is an artillery piece, and so is this. But the type of gun used boils down to the kind of target you're engaging, how far away it is, and what gun batteries are available for a fire mission. This is a mortar, and it's the simplest form of artillery. Each mortar system has four pieces: the base plate, the mount, the sight, and of course, the tube itself. Mortars are muzzle-loaded, and operating a mortar is quite simple. You and I could do it too, with minimal training.
Fire!
This is called riding the lightning, when someone stands on the base plate as a mortar fires for the first time. The recoil from the round being shot is so strong that it can shove the base plate into the ground. But for safety reasons, riding the lightning is no longer allowed. In the United States, the smallest mortar is the man-portable 60mm M224. Usually requiring a crew of three, they can lob high-explosive rounds up to 3,800 yards with an effective kill radius of about 50 feet. The higher the caliber of the mortar, the heavier the system, which is why the Israeli-designed 120mm M120s are too heavy to be carried on foot. Instead, they're transported either by truck or a specialized mortar carrier, like the M106A2 or M1129. The downside of using these specialized carriers rather than a truck is their limited firing range, because there just isn't enough room to depress the gun tube down far enough, they can only perform high-angle fire. Most other artillery pieces are capable of both high and low-angle firing, and this is generally divided by shots higher than 45 degrees and shots lower than 45 degrees. Low-angle fires are better suited for flatter, wide-open areas because the rounds have to travel less distance to reach the target. This means there is a shorter time between when the artillery is called in and the round actually impacted. High-angle is better for areas with more elevation or for targets inside of tall cover. This is especially useful for urban operations, as the artillery pieces can safely hide behind cover, shoot over the buildings, and have the impact zone in a tighter, concentrated area. But if a mortar isn't quite up for the job, or the target is a bit too far away, then the howitzer is what you'd need. This is the British-designed M777 howitzer, firing as 155mm high-explosive ammunition. Howitzers are much heavier, more powerful, and more sophisticated than mortars. You need specialized infantry to operate a howitzer. Before a howitzer can be fired, you need to dig a pit. See, a howitzer's recoil is significant. To manage this recoil, the howitzer has feet that are anchored into the ground to keep the whole system in place. The digging is done to help guide the howitzer's feet, so once the first shot is fired, the feet are secured into the ground. Kinda like grounding your opinions in facts with the help of ground news, which gives you multiple perspectives on any given news topics, and it works like this. You choose your topics of interest. For me, it's military and technology, and of course, the upcoming 2024 US election. Ground News then compiles the relevant news articles from around the world and shows their coverage across the political spectrum. For example, I was looking at the artillery equipment that the US has shipped to Ukraine. Their easy-to-use interface highlights how left, right, and center cover the same news differently, and it's a great way to cross-check information. And if I want to take a deeper dive, I can simply click on any article listed below to go to the original source. My favorite feature, of course, is the blind spot, where I can read the type of news that I don't typically follow, but could play an important role in forming my opinions. We have featured our sponsor Ground News multiple times on our channel because we find their service to be a better way to consume news. So go to ground.news/NWIT or click the link in the description to sign up and get 40% off the Vantage plan with unlimited access to all these features. Before the next shot can be fired, someone has to look into the barrel to make sure they can see the sky. It's a safety check to ensure there's no debris. Once confirmed, the next round is shoved into the breech. The long stick that's used to push the round in is called a rammer. But how come the rammer is curved and not straight? There is a good reason for this. If the barrel was pointed up at a high angle, a straight rammer would not clear the ground to get into the gun's breech. A curved rammer solves that problem.
You ready, Bubber?
Each round has a fuse that's screwed in by hand, and this determines what will actually trigger the explosion of the round. Point detonating fuses explode on impact. Delay fuses will penetrate the ground or a bunker, then detonate. Time fuses have an internal mechanism that ensures that after firing the round, it would explode after a certain amount of time. Proximity fuses, such as an Airbus round, are programmed to detonate once they reach a certain distance from the target. After the round is pushed in, someone places the charges into the breech. The charge is what propels the round. Each round comes packaged with a number of charges. Depending on the range of the target, some or all of the charges will be used. Now everything is ready, but one important thing is missing. Where do you aim exactly? Pointing a howitzer at a target is a coordinated effort which involves three parties. The fister, but don't get too excited. The fire direction center and the gun crew. Fister stands for fire support team. They're also referred to as forward observers. These are specialized soldiers who identify the target and its exact location, then plan the time that the target should be hit and the type of ammunition that should be used. This planning is done via a TD loadout.
2800 mils. Break.
All this information is relayed back to the Fire Direction Center or FDC. Given that the FDC knows the coordinates of the artillery pieces and the location of the targets, it does a small mountain of calculations to figure out the range and trajectory of the shots. They also determine how many and what type of rounds need to be fired at the target to achieve the desired results. The FDC is not the sexiest part of artillery strikes, but it's a critical step that makes a difference between a target being destroyed or just giving them tinnitus. The FDC then directly transmits the relevant information to the computer systems attached to the artillery pieces. This information tells the crew exactly how much each tube needs to be adjusted for deflection and quadrant, which is a fancy way of saying left and right, then up and down. The crew will spin the gun controls to point the barrel where it needs to go. And after a bunch of yelling, I mean the firing sequence, they pull the trigger. That's all it really takes to get warheads on foreheads. If for whatever reason the FDC cannot send the required information, the crew need to aim the artillery gun manually. First, the gun is pointed in the general direction of the target. This is called the line of fire. Then two striped sticks, called aiming points, are placed in front of the cannon, about 160 feet out. The guns are then aimed at certain points on the aiming posts. After each fire, the point of aim needs to be adjusted based on the deflection of the post. To do so, the crew look through the gun sight at the aiming posts and make the appropriate adjustments. These adjustments are done in mils, which is similar to degrees, but far more precise. Degrees can only go up to 360 in a circle, while mils max out at 6400, allowing for more fine-tuning of the point of aim. There is a big similarity between sniper fire and artillery fire, even though snipers have direct line of sight. Due to the distance from the target, a sniper can miss their shot. The spotter who's accompanying the sniper would then provide adjustments for the sniper to correct his aim. Similarly, artillery fire is unlikely to hit the target on the first try. That's why they need to do bracketing. Bracketing is basically walking the rounds onto the actual target. Once the observer sees where the shot lands, they can then provide corrections on how much it was off to adjust for the next shot. This process repeats itself until the round lands exactly where it needs to. After this is achieved, the observer calls fire for effect, and all the artillery guns that were assigned the fire mission shoot all of their assigned rounds. Howitzer batteries always aim to use the fewest number of rounds with the smallest payload possible. This not only preserves their ammo stocks, but also makes it safer for the friendly troops on the ground. You may have heard of danger close from the movies. In real life, danger close refers to any fire mission conducted within 2,000 feet of friendly forces, and is used in order to ensure any trajectories or round explosions do not impact the good guys. According to American artillery doctrine, it's usually considered safe if the risk of incapacitation is 0.1% or lower, meaning if you had a circle of 1,000 troops around an impact for some odd reason, only one of them would be limping home at the end of the day. Of course, not all artillery rounds are explosive. The M116A1 round is basically a giant smoke grenade used to obscure areas for ground forces to move through without being seen. Other rounds do the opposite, such as the M485A2 illumination round, which lights up the sky like a small star. More advanced illumination rounds are able to only produce infrared light, which means that American forces using night vision goggles can better see the area around them. But to the naked eye, it doesn't light up anything. Large artillery pieces are typically transported in one of two ways. They can be carried via helicopter to their firing position, or they can be towed behind a truck. By the way, that's not a bayonet at the tip of the muzzle. That's called the muzzle lock, which is hooked onto the back of the truck when the howitzer is being towed. Being slung underneath an aircraft is good for getting the guns to a remote location quickly, and it looks way cooler. But having their own vehicles allows for artillery crews to shoot and scoot. That's because once an artillery gun or mortar has fired, it's very easy for local radar systems to detect where the shot came from. This has been a massive issue for both sides in the Russo-Ukrainian war, where artillery batteries must quickly move as soon as they're done firing, or risk being destroyed by incoming shells. While the vehicle on the screen might look like a tank, it's actually the third way artillery guns get around the battlefield. They can drive themselves. This is an M109 Paladin self-propelled artillery gun, and you'll find these supporting American mechanized formations. The logic behind using a self-propelled artillery gun is that you need a firing platform that can move as quickly as the tanks and other armored vehicles it's supporting do. Though visually similar to a main battle tank, their armor is actually quite thin and can only stop shrapnel and some small arms fire. Artillery operations have not been exempt from the impact of drones in today's warfare. The use of drones for artillery spotting by both Ukraine and Russia has drastically increased the lethality of artillery missions. Instead of a spotter using approximate coordinates and adjusting the shots after, having a bird's eye view allows for more accurate targeting, and adjustments can be fed directly to the FTC via the drone link. According to a recent study by the UK, Russian artillery crews that operated their own drones were able to hit targets just 3 minutes after detecting them from the air. Without drones, it would take almost 30 minutes to hit the target after being first called in by a fister on the ground.